Hi students, so in the last session we have seen about minimum mode configuration of 8086. In today's session we are going to see about the maximum mode configuration of 8086. So the same process continues like in minimum mode configuration. We have seen in an order about introduction of minimum mode configuration, what is minimum mode configuration and what are the signals of minimum mode configuration, block diagram explanation and signals explanation, and finally timing diagram. The same order follows in maximum mode also. So as first part in maximum mode, let us discuss about the basic points and basic knowledge and important points about maximum mode configuration now. So the maximum mode operation is generally selected by connecting the MN/MX bar, the bar is to MX bar, to ground. So here maximum bar is to MX bar, so it is connected to ground. So then only 8086 operates in maximum mode. Unlike in minimum mode, it is connected to VCC or it is connected to logic 1. In maximum mode, it is connected to ground. So the 8086 is operated in maximum mode in multiprocessor system with more than one processor. So in maximum mode operation, in maximum mode environment, there will be more number of processors and our 8086 interfaces with one or more other processors. Okay, so in maximum mode, the control signals are generated by the external bus controller 8288. So here comes a new device into picture. This is called as 8288. Its name is bus controller. So in maximum mode, in minimum mode, 8086 itself controls everything, operation and everything, but in maximum mode it just behaves as a processor and it associates with another processors, and the bus controller will take all the control actions, all the control signals and all the control operations that are under the control of our bus controller 8288. This is maximum mode configuration. Okay, so the maximum mode operation is used only when the system contains arithmetic coprocessor such as 8087 numeric coprocessor. So 8086, if any interface, means the interface can be happen only between two devices having some similar function. So like that, 8086 is likely to interface with any arithmetic coprocessor, such as example for arithmetic coprocessors are 8087 numeric coprocessors. Okay, so the maximum mode signals are these one: QS1, QS0, S0 bar, S1, S2, lock signal, RQ/GT, RQ/GT1, GT0. So these 8 are the maximum mode signals. You won't be able to see any data related signals and any address related signals like in minimum mode. In minimum mode, we are having address latch enable, data enable, all those signals, but in maximum mode there won't be any signals in our microprocessors, but those all signals will be in 8288 bus controller. Okay, so we'll see in depth about all these signals in later slides. So let us discuss a few points about 8086 maximum mode configuration. So when the 8086 is set for the maximum mode configuration, it provides signals for implementing a multiprocessor coprocessor system environment. So whenever MN/MX bar is connected to ground, then 8086 turns itself into a multiprocessor environment and it will be very ready and very likely to interface with the other processors in the system. By multiprocessor environment, we mean that one processor exists in the system and that each processor is executing its own program. That means in multiprocessor system, there exist many processors and each processor drives its own program and all those will share the bus. So usually in these type of environment, there are some system resources that are common to all processors. They are called as global resources. There are also other resources that are assigned to specific processor. These are known as local or private resources. So in this line, you may come across two points that are global resources and private resources. So let me give you an example here. So you know LAN connection, right? So we are having a local area network LAN connection, and LAN is connected to many systems. Okay, so for many computers, or else if you take any software office or else any laboratory in your own colleges, you can consider it. So if you have LAN, then it can be shared by each and every system. So LAN is nothing but a global resource. Okay, so LAN is nothing but a global resource which is for all the processors or all the systems available in that particular environment. Okay. But for this particular monitor, there will be RAM, right? So special memory, RAM, or else for keyboard, like that, only some elements that are restricted to only but to this particular device. Like these devices are called as private resources, okay, or else local resources. So there are two resources, one is global resources and local resources in any multiprocessor environment. So global resources are shared by all the processors in that particular environment, and local processors are shared by only by that particular device. Okay, so next one, coprocessor also means there is a second processor in the system. In this, two processor does not access the bus at the same time. So in multiprocessor environment, one is called as coprocessor only if there is another physical presence of another processor is there. So if two processors are there, then they won't access the bus at same time and they'll share the bus. So one passes the control of the system bus to the other, and then it may suspend its operation. So one bus completes its operation and then it shares the bus to another processor. That means like that they will share the bus. Okay. So in the maximum mode of 8086 system, facilities are provided for implementing allocation of global resources and passing bus control to the microprocessor or coprocessor. Okay, so in maximum mode system, facilities are provided for implementing the allocation of global resources. So majorly they concentrate on global resources, then passing bus control to other processor or coprocessor. Okay, so these are the main points that we have to discuss about maximum mode configuration. Here comes the block diagram of maximum mode configuration. You can see, you can find similarity from minimum mode to maximum mode only at latches, data buffers. Here data buffers are there, and those data buffers are called as transceivers in minimum mode configuration, and here RAM, ROM, all the memory elements are here. Okay, so and the first point comes here is in 8086 MN/MX bar is grounded. Okay, so this is the very first notation and the very important notation that you have to present in your exam. So in this block diagram, so MN/MX bar is connected to ground, and there is a clock generator. So from clock generator, it is connected to our 8086. As we have already discussed about these pins in minimum mode, AD0 to AD15, all these pins, and these are multiplexed address cum data lines. These are given to our latches. Okay, so as well as our data buses. So in from latches, it comes the A0 to A19, only address pins will come out, and address bus is always unidirectional. Okay, it is having only single direction, and here these are data buffers. So from data buffers, you can get original data D0 to D15 original data. You can see the data bus is always bidirectional. It is having arrow marked 2 points, and data buses and address buses are associating with RAM, ROM as well as IO devices. Okay, so now coming to the major point of 8086, and we have already seen in the very first introduction of 8086 maximum mode, I told you that in maximum mode 8086 gives its control to 8288 bus controller whenever it is operating in maximum mode. So in 8086 operation, there are status pins S2, S1, S0, all are active low signals. Via this status pins, it is connected to our bus controller. I'll show you the pin diagram of bus controller and I'll show you the signals of bus controller in the next slides. So the pins are same here, the status pins S0, S1, S2. So the pins are connected to 8288 bus controller, and you can clearly see there are address latch enable and DEN pin and data transmit or receiver pin. These are the signals that we have observed in our minimum mode configuration, but in 8288 bus controller, these are the pins of 8288 bus controller and these are connected to this one. So see here, I'll show you with different ink. So see here, this address latch enable is connected to latches, address latches, and this DEN bar to data buffers, as well as this data transmit or receive bar is also connected to data buffers. Okay, so the address latch enable always refers to address, and DEN or data transmit or receive bar refer to our data signal. So these are connected to data buffers and it is having INTA bar signal, and these are the outputs of our 8288 bus controller. MRDC bar, MWTC bar, IORC bar, IOWC bar. Apart from these, we are having AIORC bar, IOWC bar, like this, those signals will also be there. So I'm going to tell you what are those signals also. And this BHE bar, if you see here, BHE bar and A0 pin is connected to our control system logic. So this control system logic, it decides whether it is a byte operation or word operation in maximum mode configuration. Not only in maximum mode, the combination of BHE bar and A0 will always decides the whether we are doing a byte operation or word operation in memory or IO device. So this is the block diagram of maximum mode configuration, and this is very, very important one. And here we are going to see our 8288 bus controller now. So actually, while presenting 8086 maximum mode configuration, you need not present these in your examinations, and this information about 8288 is only for your educational and knowledgeable purpose. Okay, because without knowing all these signals and all, we don't be able to understand the complete operation and timing diagrams of 8086. So this is 8288 pin diagram. You can see there are pins S1 bar, S0 bar. I'm going to discuss only pins that we are going to use in our operation. S2 bar, as well as data enable bar, DEN, INTA, IORC, AIOWC, IOWC, MWTC, AMWC, MRDC, ALE, and we are having AEN, IOB clock signals, and these are all there in our 8288 bus controller. So we are going to discuss about only few pins there, and those are the outputs of our maximum mode. So first one is MRDC. MRDC stands for memory read command. So what memory read? See, the name itself indicates it is a command. Okay, command is nothing but passing some instruction to something, whether it is memory or IO device. So all the definitions starts with instructs. Okay, it instructs the memory to put the contents of addressed location on the data bus. So memory read command instructs the memory, it tells the memory to put the contents of the address location on the data bus. So this is the operation of our memory read command. And next one is MWTC. So this is memory write command. So it instructs the memory to accept the data on the data bus and load the data into addressed memory location. Nothing but write operation of memory. So IORC also, it is a instruction command. It instructs it. If it is MRDC, it is instructing our memory. If it is IORC, it is devising a IO device. Okay, so IO device to put the data contained in address to port on the data bus. IOWC, so IOWC, it instructs an IO device to accept the data on the data bus and load the data into the addressed port. Okay, so IORC and IOWC, so these are the commands for IO device reading and writing. So you can see here you are having AIOWC and ANWC. These comes advanced IO write command and advanced memory write command. So these signals are similar to same IOWC and MWTC, except they are activated one clock pulse earlier. That means if MRDC starts here and AMRDC already have started here, that means in timing only it differs. So advanced means one clock pulse earlier this signal will get, AMRDC, AMWC signal will get activated. Okay, so these are the pins of 8 to 8. It is good to present all these pins, but these are not necessary and these are not compulsorily to present in your 8086 maximum mode configuration. So these are the pins that I have told you now. So okay, without knowing about these pins you won't be able to understand the timing diagram. So now quickly move into the pins. There are 8 pins in 8086 which works for maximum mode like in 8 minimum mode also. So pin 24 to 31 varies from minimum mode to maximum mode. So in this maximum mode these pins are called as maximum mode signals. So what are the signals means, so you can see here maximum mode, this is the maximum mode and you have to see from pin number 24 to 31 you are having QS1, QS0, S0, S1, S2, log bar, request, grant, like these signals are there. So pin 24 is QS1, pin 20 is QS0. These two pins together called as Q status pins. And pin 26 is S0 bar, pin 21 is S1 bar, pin 22 is S2 bar. And these three pins together called as status pins. Pin 29 is lock bar, pin 31 are request or grant signals. So signals are having with bar are active low signals. Okay, so these are the maximum mode signals. So these are Q status, status lines, lock signal, request or grant. Okay, so you can see that there is no specific or applied operations, applied names for these maximum mode signals unlike in minimum mode signal. So now let us see, let's cover everything in detail. So QS1 and QS0, these Q status pins indicates the status of instruction Q of 8086 processor. So in 8086 processor these indicate the status of instruction Q. So we know instruction Q, it is having a 6 bytes of instruction Q. So what it does, so sorry for the mistake, so this is the combination 00011011. When both are 0 there will be no operation. When 01 is there then it takes the first byte of opcode. When 10 the Q is empty. 11 next byte of opcode. So what is first byte of opcode, second byte of opcode means, so opcode stands for operation code. Okay, so if you want to let me tell you a small example for that one. So this is 1 plus 2, this is what a man can read. Okay, or else a human can read 1 plus 2. Okay, so whenever if you are doing the same 1 plus 2 in any other program, that means if you are doing it to a machine, you can give add 1, 2. So this is nothing but an instruction. Okay, so this add is called as mnemonic. Okay, so we have already discussed this mnemonics in our first session. So this is add 1, 2, this is instruction. So this is what we are going to give our mission. So actually this instruction is completely decoded into hexadecimal format. Like that BE0027, BE0028, 28. Like that, you can see in your laboratory, in your manuals, there is an empty column for opcode in for MC8086 programming. So in that you will be able to write like this one. So this is hexadecimal code that represents the operation by the processor. Okay, so that is called as operation code. So how processor understands the hexadecimal code. Okay, so this is the queue status, and here pins are there S1, S2, S3. These are the status signals indicates the function of current bus cycle. So what is our bus cycle is doing, whether it is doing reading operation, writing operation, or it is acknowledging any interrupt, or else it is associated with memory or IO. These status signals indicates the functions depending upon the combinations. You can see here, see, don't confuse, all are these low signals, and here we are taking our signals as normal signals S2 S1 S0. So depending upon the combinations, if all are 0, it is interrupt acknowledgement, S0 is 1 IO read, S1 is 1 IO write, and S1 S0 are 1s, then it is halt signal. So if it is 100, it is opcode fetch, 101, it is memory read, 110 is memory write, 111 is inactive. So these are the status of current bus cycle. What is the operation that bus cycle is now doing at this instant of time, and during this present bus cycle, the status pins will tell you. So lock signal. So lock signal indicates that the processor is executing a lock prefixed instruction, and the system bus is not to be used by any other bus master. That means this signal prevents other bus masters from taking the control of system bus during the execution of critical instruction. So it tells whenever if you are, see, you can put lock at AX comma BX like this. If you give like this any instruction, before the instruction if you keep any lock, means then 8086 treats that instruction as a high prioritized instruction, and it won't gives your bus access to any other system or any other processor until the execution of complete program. So lock prevents our system bus to be utilized by another instruction. Okay, so next one is request or grant. So request or grant pins are used in DMA operation during the maximum mode operation. These both are bidirectional signals are used to request and grant the DMA operation. In direct memory access, you will be clearly able to see about request and grant signals. So the timing diagram is explained in these following steps. You can see here, this is the maximum mode system 8086 system read cycle. Here this is memory read, okay, and this is the clock signal. So in clock signal we are having one machine cycle. One machine cycle is also called as a bus cycle. It is having 4 time slots, T1, T2, T3, T4, okay. So address latch enable, ALE is there. So it is always 1 for first time period, and during this one, these S2 bar to S0 bar are in active state. So only when these are active, then only our address pins and status pins, as well as address and data pins, will be demultiplexed together. Okay, and here you can see this is a read operation, like in minimum mode operation, as same way this gap will come between address and data. Okay. And this is memory read operation. So MRDC bar will be low here. Okay. So MRDC bar will be low here in this one, and data transmit are enabled. So you are getting reception of data, this is read, so reading of the data will also be low by starting of T2 cycle, and data enable bar will be high whenever data comes into picture. Okay, in this way you have to write your maximum mode read cycle. So let me explain you this in 2 steps. So S2, S0, S1, S2 are set at the beginning of bus cycle on detecting any change in these passive state. So S1, S2, S2 is equal to 1. The bus controller will output a pulse on its ALE. So whenever these signals, okay, S2 to S0 bar, these signals will be on. Then bus controller will output a pulse on ALE and apply a required signal to its DT/R bar during T1. So during T1 it transfers the ALE pulse, and at the same time, whether this is reading or writing, if this is reading it lows the signal, if it is writing then it is highs the signal. So in T2, A2 88 will set DEN bar is equal to 1. Thus, by enabling the transceiver for an input 8288, it will activate MRDC or IORC. Okay. So these signals are activated until T4. So during this T2 cycle, so it enables the transceiver, and after transceiver, for till T4 and the signals will be in on state, and it will active in T2 only, it activates MRDC or IORC signals. Okay, so here memory read cycle, that's why this signal came into our picture. This is the output of one of the outputs of our 8288. Okay, this is the maximum mode read timing diagram, and now maximum mode write timing diagram. See here, this is a clock pulse. Okay, so same, there is a clock pulse and address/enable is enabled at the first pulse during T1, and same S2 S0 status pins are there, and add our status lines. So this is address A19 to A16, and after that BHE bar is there and the status pins are there, and here address or data pins. Whenever address is latched A0 to A15 and data out, since we are doing write operation, we are having data with us, there won't be any gap between address and data. Okay, D0 to D15, and AMWC or AIOWC, you can see there. So these are advanced memory write signal, and this is memory write signal. So these are low here from here. Okay, so and by starting of T1 itself, okay, by starting of T1 itself, a advanced memory write, so it is one clock pulse beyond the memory write signal, and memory write signal will be exactly starts at T2. Okay, so this will be the low signal here. DT/R bar, writing means we are transmitting data, so this is a high signal. It is representing high here, and DEN bar is also low at the starting of T2. Okay, so this is the maximum mode write timing in diagram. And now for an output, the AMWC, IOWC are activated from T2 to T4, and MWC, IOC are activated from T3 to T4. So as we have already seen, this advanced means one clock pulse earlier, T2 to T4, this is T3 to T4. The status pins S0 to S2 remain active until T3 and becomes passive during T3 and T4. If ready input is not activated before T3, wait state will be inserted between the T3 and T4. So if there is a ready, if there is no activation of ready signal before T3, and there will be another time pulse called as TW in between T3 and T4. Okay, for minimum mode configuration, TW, that we have to give it compulsorily, but in maximum mode configuration, it depends on the ready signal. So this is about maximum mode configuration. In maximum mode configuration, we have seen memory reading diagram and also memory write diagram also. So yeah, in maximum mode, we have, let me give you a brief explanation what points that we have covered in maximum mode. So in maximum mode, initially we have seen about what is maximum mode and what is coprocessor, multiprocessor environment. In multiprocessor environment, we have new terms called global resources and local resources and general examples. And in multiprocessor environment, 8086 controls, it gives all the controls to 8288 bus controller, and we have seen the block diagram of maximum mode configuration. And after block diagram of maximum configuration, we have discussed a very few points about 8288 bus controller and its output signals, as well as after that, following that, we have seeing the operation of maximum mode, and then we have seeing all the signals and maximum mode signals of 8086, and as well as timing diagrams in both memory read and memory write. So I hope you are clear with the maximum mode configuration of 8086.